So I think that it's they've written a spec, which is fairly nice for its use cases, but I think that it probably hasn't been challenged with against many developers with different backgrounds to see if they can actually use it. And I think that the first priority now should be to first check the spec against developers. Put the spec to developers and see if they can use it. Just like any random JavaScript person coming into the room. I don't think they've done that. But secondarily, can a machine understand the things that are in the linked data profile server and start to develop or to understand so much of this that it's actually going to be able to make use of the data in a non-intuitive way? And I'd like to start out with illustrating, for example, okay, so I have this site. Yeah, you came up with the perfect example now, just in a previous conversation, that there is a site with stations for trains, and I have some information about the station. For example, there is a really nice coffee shop over there. I'd like to add some information about the station and the coffee shop. How do I do that? Well, first of all, you have to be authenticated and authorized to do that. Okay, so how do you authenticate and get authorized to edit that resource? There is nothing in the specification that tells you how to do this.
Do you need this?
Not that I could find.
HTTP already says that it's about this.
No, you should consider this linked data platform as an add-on on top of HTTP
yes.
itself. We actually tackled with linked data platform. We had a project of a content management system that would be fully based on semantic web technologies. And we did try to tackle with linked data platforms. Actually, I would disagree with the first sentence.
Okay, right.
But things first things. About authorization, I think HTTP already says everything about this. There are headers, there are procedures, there are a few additional specs regarding HTTP itself related to challenges, origins, etc., etc. So I think it should be
okay.
Linked data
platform. I think so. We're talking about different things there because obviously HTTP has that kind of stuff. But you're coming in there as an authorized user. You're getting a resource about a station.
Mm-hmm.
I want to edit that.
Mm-hmm.
But it doesn't now say that because in linked data profile you have the allow header that says get, put, delete, post, and so on.
But this HTTP says not linked data profile.
Hmm. Yeah. but the trouble is that if you're going in as an unauthorized user.
Mm-hmm.
Of course it doesn't say that you can do these things. You have to be authorized to see that allow header.
But again, I think it's not for the linked data platform spec itself. I think we are talking about some kind of hypermedia specification.
Exactly.
I think it's more like for a Hydra, let's say,
yeah,
to decide when each action should be doable, not the linked data platform.
So right. Right. So you think
because
it's an author.
If we put everything in linked data platform, we will create a huge golem that will just fall apart because
yeah.
of the heavy weight.
Exactly.
That's my opinion.
Yeah. So I agree that this is how the hypermedia it should be in some hypermedia things.
It should be, but not in linked data platform.
You don't think it should be because that's
linked data platform. It's about working with data.
Mm-hmm.
This is my understanding of the spec. But it's hypermedia spec to decide how and when this data should be worked
mm.
with.
But my problem as a developer then is that I don't know. Can I just try to authorize against the resource that I'm viewing? Can I just push out my credentials and
how
see
do
what
you work with a website?
So
you don't think, can I get this whistle with authentication or without? You don't care. No, no. You just try get.
Yeah.
Okay, you can get 401 or any kind of 4 exception, but you don't care. You just try the easiest way.
Mm.
I think it should be the same.
If you have...
you can try always to send a put.
But basically what you have in a website is typically a form that tells a human user.
But form is created according to Hypermedia specification.
Yes, exactly.
HTML is a Hypermedia here.
So what I'm saying here is that without this Hypermedia, yes. I can't even get started.
Exactly.
I can't even get to the point where I'm authorized to do any of the things that LDP is about.
Yes,
so this Hypermedia control is, in my opinion, something that you actually need in LDP to make it useful.
Yes, but imagine HTML as in Hypermedia here, but working with data probably would be driven by, let's say, JavaScript code. And JavaScript and HTML are just completely different specs. So that's why I wouldn't mix those as well as living data platform.
Okay, yes, but the comparison is a bit difficult because with HTML you can describe anything, with JavaScript you can program anything. For this specific case, that doesn't really apply, but I think where I want to get at is, on one hand you said, you know, authentication and stuff has to be fixed by some Hypermedia spec, Hydra,
yeah,
whatever.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I think the question is, like, can't we do everything with that? Because what bothers me about LDP is that it's a rule set. Like, LDP has these rules you can do, there's no Hypermedia information matter what whatsoever. Whereas you could imagine, like, suppose we don't have the LDP spec, you have just Hypermedia saying, look, this is a website, if you authorize, you can edit station information, you can
mm-hmm.
edit a shop to this. So
mm-hmm.
basically the question becomes then, is Hypermedia not sufficient to do it? Just like on the HTML version on
mm-hmm.
the web, you have only Hypermedia, you have no spec for let's not edit stuff, because it's not necessary. So maybe Hypermedia is really what we need, and not the LDP spec.
Good point. Good point, and I agree. But I think that, let's say Hydra, because I'm somehow involved in Hydra itself. I maybe not that active user, but still Hydra does not tell a lot of things that actually Link Data Platform says.
Well, the thing is, Hydra is very generic, of course. So, I mean, it's like HTML form, HTML link, you can build anything with that. But I personally, I see more future in extending Hydra for specific cases.
Yeah, but again, why extending Hydra? Why not having a separate spec that can be built on top of Hydra or whatever?
Well, yeah, that would be good. But I think because LDP is not built on any Hypermedia, so I think the point is LDP is not built on a Hypermedia spec. So it's not extensible, it's just, those are the rules, take them or leave them,
no
way to discover them.
But the issue is, for instance, now let's take a look again into the Hydra and LDP comparison. As far as I can remember, Hydra itself does not have anything to authentication itself. It does not tell when and how which operation can be run.
That's right.
So it's even, 0-0. But, for instance, in Link Data Platform, I think the latest spec actually puts some extra HTTP headers that can be used by, let's say, a code or a machine to browse the data more efficiently,
well,
like paging, next, etc., etc.
Yes, but again, we use a Hypermedia argument here. I mean, there's no website that uses, well, there are a few websites that use a spec for authentication. They just have a form, you log in, username, password, and so on, except for OAuth, of course, and stuff. But with Hydra, it would work that way. So instead of having this spec, like, this is how you authenticate, you have, this is a form, and the client knows, okay, it's a form I have to fill out, apparently username and a password, I do that, and then I'm able to do stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be the alternative, basically. So don't spec it and go along as you...
True.
I mean, and the thing is, of course, for us humans, this works. I mean, we can read the form, we can understand, okay, if I fill this out, I'll be able to do more.
Mm-hmm.
For a machine, this whole reasoning that we have is much more difficult, but I think also personally more interesting. Because for me, LDP circumvents a problem. Like, we just spec everything and then we have an argument. Well, then we don't have any arguments because
mm-hmm.
both sides follow the agreements, that's it. Whereas with Hypermedia, it's more an on-demand contract, something that can dynamically change and do things that.
So I don't know too much about LDAP, but the question is then, if you have a generic API for authentication, that there will be like 20 different ways to authenticate. Mm-hmm. And you need, if you ask something, mostly specs is about making a standard, so that we don't have to argue about how we interact always. So this is a bit why probably it's good to have like one idea how authentication is done and keep it this way.
So I I think that authentication is something that's protocol based. So you're on a different abstraction layer semantically. Mm-hmm. I think that the way I would do it is that I would say authenticate. You have a predicate basically, or a class of things that says this is how you authenticate, and in the context of HTTP, this is how you authenticate, and then you point to the HTTP specification where things are define how you authenticate given HTTP. So you have a two-layer approach there where the semantics is clear at the top, this is how you authenticate. And
would it make sense to just have a site specification how you authenticate at this service?
That's basically one of the other points of criticism I have against LDP is that it's tied to HTTP.
Mm-hmm.
Imagine if you did that in HTML, that you said that we're going to use just HTTP, then you exclude all the content that is, for example, in RTSP.
Then leaked data is bound to HTTP.
It's philosophically, it's not really bound to HTTP, although HTTP is more or less the only reasonable choice right now. But you could imagine other protocols sending RDF data as a payload, for example, within a video.
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't need to be. It's the orthogonality between the specification is maintained, I think. I think that's a key point, and that's why I would advocate also this for authentication, that you have this this semantic layer where you say this is where you go to this URI to authenticate.
Do people adapt LDP?
I don't know.
That's a bit the question, because if they adapt, then probably there was need for the specification. If they don't adapt it, it will go away anyway.
Yeah. So I have no idea there.
Who's using LDP?
Clap me up on my.
Can you self-tap yourself?
But we're running out of time for this topic anyway. So,
did we come to a conclusion? Like,
yeah.
Are we going to forget about LDP?
Last word spoken where LDP will go away.
So, if it will be adapted, then it stays. If not, it will go away, which is mostly with specs.
Yeah.
So for every discussion topic, we would like to end with like a main takeaway, if necessary, for pro and con.
Mm-hmm.
So what might be your main takeaway here?
I would say that it has to be superseded by hypermedia in some way.
I agree.
I don't know enough about LDP for that.
So I guess this is a good closing. Oh, yeah. All right. We'll move to the next discussion topic.
Hi, I'm Christina Sarasua from the University of Koblenz-Landau, and the discussion I would like to propose is that interlinking is more than RCMS. The fourth link data principle suggests that we should include links to other URIs so that more things can be discovered. When it comes to interlinking, these links connect resources of different RDF datasets. Besides vocabulary links, we can distinguish two types of links. Identity links, to indicate that two RDF descriptions refer to the same resource, and domain-specific links, which connect two different resources to extend the description of the first one. Studies have shown that interlinking efforts have mostly focused on identity links, and the situation is similar when it comes to link discovery algorithms and benchmarking initiatives. So the question I want to raise is whether we should push the creation of domain-specific links. And I think we definitely should do it, because this can enrich the link data space. When we think of doing it, it is important to discuss a methodological framework. Should we systematically create links that extend descriptions with who, where, and when information? Should we do this guided by the properties in the LOV vocabularies? And how should we consider the popularity and contextual relevance of predicates and target resources? Regarding link discovery methods, domain-specific links may not always be created by comparing property values, like when we are geolocating an event and we don't have any address information. And in such cases, automatic link discovery tools might become challenging, and therefore we need human computation. Related to that, how should this be triggered? Should we use general human knowledge, or should we reproduce what is already on the web? So the question is how to do it. And the last thing is how to extend evaluation campaigns to include these kind of links and not only identity links. I leave here the summary of questions, and if you would like to share your thoughts, I've created an etherpad. Thank you very much.
Could we use Google Docs?
Link to it, maybe, from the docs.
Yeah. Right,
mm-hmm.
Is
any
people come forward?
Sure, I can. Maybe. So, I'll try to go in the order of the questions, I suppose. Should we improve the current situation and why? Most definitely, because I mean, I'm sure you are aware that sameAs just doesn't cut it. Like you have when you deal with different sorts of concepts from different domains, which may be of interest to someone else if it is interlinked, but the quality of that interlink and the degree of their similarity matters. So it's not just a matter of, you know, that and that is the same thing or not, but, you know, to what extent, whether it incorporates the temporality, I think she mentioned that at some point. Temporality matters a lot. The creation of domain links, how to boost it. I would think of two areas. One is the from the publisher, which has to do with the quality of the data and or the metadata that's provided with it. And the other side is the consumer, which is, I would say, has to do with some sort of a domain expert. So it's not just a machine just taking all that stuff in and reusing it, but a human, you know, looks over the stuff and sees whether whatever's being consumed is of interest to their data and whether it makes sense to use it. The reason, the domain that I'm thinking of is actually in statistical data sets. And where it matters a lot is with when you have to do comparisons. So comparability of two data sets matters a lot. If you need to do some sort of a correlation analysis or whatever, you need to know whether it makes any sense to compare these two things. So for example, let's say one data set is talking about me and my shoe size over the years, and the other data set is about the average temperature in Europe. So, you know, I could probably put up a chart there that shows that, you know, as the size of my feet is increasing over the years, it's also impacting global warming. Whatever. Of course, the machine can tell me that is the case, but in the end, you need the human to tell you whether, you know, that is of interest, or it may be of interest, but it may not be. So you need to have somebody on top of it babysitting, you know, the relations, so, and the degree of that. So on one, you have the type of, let's say, SCOS, just a simple example of, like, you know, exact match, or close match, or related match, or, it could be more granular than that, of course. But on one hand, we need to sort of, you know, have these domain links. But the other part is, even if it is in there, you need to know whether it incorporates, let's say, in the statistical data, you have to know if it's a country, for example, right? A country from one data set and a country from another data set. A country is not a country. It depends on which body or ISO or other standardization you're asking. You know, one of them may acknowledge a particular part of the world as a country, other one may not. So if, let's say, the World Bank says this is, you know, Taiwan is a country or it's not a country, and this other data set from IMF says that this is a country or not a country, well, you know, can you interlink those things? Is Taiwan from this data set the same as Taiwan from this other data set? And you have to know whether it's, you have the difference between geopolitical countries or economic countries or...
So you say there are different, there's stuff which is not same as.
Yeah, most of the things are not.
So then you just don't underlink it. Or do you propose like having other things which are making relations? Like right now you're saying there's stuff which is same as and stuff which is not same as and we should not link because it's not exactly the same.
I'm saying most things are not same as, especially concepts.
So we should not link it.
It's a trade-off. Like if it is of use, if you can, it has to do with the communication and how you explain what you're showing. So if you can communicate that this chart is of use to someone and you're clear about this is comparable, mm-hmm. then okay, same as is fine. But otherwise, you should probably not bother.
I believe interlinking is again contextual mm-hmm. because as your example with countries, it depends on the context. In political context, sometimes we don't know even whether the Taiwan is a country because from political point of view, someone says that it's not, but someone says, okay, it's a country, but China would invade this country.
So we need the same as with some features attached.
Yeah, exactly, with some additional description of which context they describe. So it depends because, okay, it's all same as, but you can imagine another ontology mm-hmm. that says same as, maybe it extends as a... I say all same as, but in completely different context. So that's what I.
So, I mean, it's a semantical problem in a great sense. But if I think pragmatically, I mean, does this really work if you want to build applications and they have to deal with all these new nuances in the?
You have to deal with this because everyday life we are touching these nuances.
And I felt I mean, strictly speaking, I could say, okay, the DBpedia URI only means that particular concepts mm-hmm. in the context of DBpedia, like they're the only ones. I mean, that is, this concept is identified by this URI because of all the data that DBpedia puts around it.
I would focus on how DBpedia describe this URI as a concept. Imagine that DBpedia has this Taiwan somewhere. Mm-hmm. And imagine there is a predicate DBpedia colon country. What does it mean, colon country? What's the definition? What is the semantics? What is the description underneath this term country? And how this it is expressed? Is it expressed in axioms? Or is it expressed in natural language?
So,
I'm sorry. You see, I think the problem is that, well, ontologies are very strict, right? So when
yes.
you say the DBpedia Taiwan is same as some other definition of Taiwan,
mm-hmm.
you don't analyze the definition of whatever DBpedia Taiwan actually is, the DBpedia ontology country, right?
Mm-hmm.
But you're actually entering some kind of fuzzy logic here, because if you make a query and you ask, show me famous people from Taiwan, a human understands intuitively that, okay, so I mean Chinese citizens or Taiwanese citizens, I don't care, but I mean people who live on the island of Taiwan, or, well,
you mean people living on island of Taiwan.
When I think about somewhere now...
So you
change
the context. You are talking about an island, a geographical place,
but
not a political
this
place.
This is a... it is fuzzy logic, right? So
okay.
It's not that straightforward, even for a human. Because when
yeah,
I think about some more...
Context.
When I think a bit some more, it could also mean people who identify themselves as Taiwanese, right?
True.
So... And ontologies that just don't cut it because they are too strict. Same as, okay, these are exact sames. And
I just wanted to mention, so I was not sure, I was hesitating to mention from the place, but actually I think the same as is really not enough, because most often when we create the ontology or we link, we want to put some meaning. And most often it's not so strict as the same as. And even with the biggest problem with the same as, I think, is the transitivity. So if you put that something is the same as something, and then this, the second thing, is the same as something, the first and the second may not be really so the same as. But the same as, which is defined by Orwell, it will define it actually exactly the same. So that's why people come up with scores when you have this broader as and so on. And you have, I think, like same as, but not transitive. So that it's not so strong, and so people really recognize that this is needed.
But when it goes to very specific needs, scores may not be enough either. You would have to come up with very, very specific terms for. So okay, so I want citizens of Taiwan, which means I want people who were either born in Taiwan, or maybe Taiwan is not a country anymore. I want people, famous people from the USSR, right? Do I mean former USSR, or maybe Kazakhstan qualifies as well? And
That's up to you, I guess. But I mean, I would try somehow to specify the most common necessary cases that are not the same as. And I think like SCOS is one point, but I think another point is also because we're working with an application in engineering domain, and what we do what we have in our use case is that we have to transform data. And when you have to transform data, you really have to define exactly what should be done. It's not really linking, it's more like mapping. But we really miss somehow, like, I don't know, some mathematical operations or something that you can exactly specify how to deal with the data. And maybe some general techniques, like about the transformations, could also help. Not only the like one-to-one, but I don't know.
Okay, so this is an interesting remark, because the mapping that you are doing is actually shaping the context in which some of these links may be actually true. So from the semantics point of view, no finite number of properties and no finite amount of information will ever suffice in order to conclude that two things are the same. So you can have a meaningful conversation with somebody, you can even interact with somebody for decades without knowing that this person means something slightly different with Paris than you do. So you can go on vacation with the guy, or you can go do administrations, work in the same government and talk about Paris and do all types of governmental stuff in Paris without ever discovering that this person is actually meaning something slightly different with Paris than you are. So identity is very strict. No finite amount of information will ever ensure that two things are the same. And similarity is actually the other way around, because everything is similar to everything in order to some extent. So I would still go for context. But the question is, what should this context be? And then I think the remark about the more practical thing is very interesting. So we are doing this practical mapping based on first name, last name, maybe shared temporally or something like that, something Savin mentioned about the temporal aspect. So this is actually an algorithm. So you have an algorithm which decides whether something is the same as something else. And that algorithm is, I think, the context. And the algorithm is written in a programming language, which has a clear semantics, because otherwise if not a programming language, the compiler would not be able to execute it. So I think the program is actually the context here. But the program is not shared. So we only see the identity link, and we don't know whether it is based on first name, last name, or based on something completely different. And maybe that is at least my suggestion to make the notion of context slightly more concrete. So the context, I think, should be the algorithm that does the mapping.
Still talking about the context. First of all, a question. Are we agreeing that same as relation is also not only transitive, but also reflexive, or reflexive, actually? If I say that A is same as B, also the other way around is true, right? That B is same as, at least formally speaking, okay. So there is, in my opinion, another bit of context that we have to consider. That is the authorial activity made by someone, that is an agent, a human, or even a software, okay, that adds that particular annotation. Because if I say that A is same as of B. I'm saying that. And no one that has created that B in some any linked data stuff is actually aware of what I'm saying. So it's a personal interpretation, not only a contextual interpretation. I mean, that I'm saying, okay, this A in that context is equal to B in that context. But it's more than that. There's another level, another layer, that is the authorial one, that I say, look, that author is saying that this particular relation is the same as.
So it's and opinion.
From that point of view, more or less, everything is true. If you consider the authorial layer there, anyone can say that A is same as B, since because basically there is an author, there is a provenance of who is saying that particular relation. So it's a true assertion. Even if
I would just change the perspective,
yeah.
Because at the end people are reading same as.
Yeah.
So I would actually propose that we might keep same as, but that we need to specify for which use case we are allowed to use which same as. Because this is what Sarvan was beginning with. For some use cases, it's typically fine to say Taiwan is the same as DBpedia and in this data set. For other use cases, statistical, it's not at all allowed to do this because it's really fine. So probably same as should be taken care of by the consumer, and that the consumer needs a way to decide if this same as is valid in this context which he wants to use it or not.
No, you are speaking about how to use the data that are already there. That's the point. Right?
Or the one which it was created. But I guess it's a bit then, you say, I am doing this same as based on this.
Exactly.
Premises,
it's something
that I need then for the use case to decide with this premise or with these conditions, I can use it for my use case.
In addition to that, also you can trust, eventually, the author that is made the same as or not trust. So it's not only matter of the triples itself. It's also a matter, I would like to use that particular relation because I trust the author that make, they actually made that relation.
Exactly, okay, we have a context, but we have a person or whoever says that.
Agents.
It's a matter of what kind of authority this whoever says about this is. So actually, modern knowledge is about authority because someone did research and said some statement, created some ideas, etc., and he published it, and we can believe him or not. Maybe some people will confirm that, but there is a knowledge that cannot be somehow confirmed because it's related to some, I don't know, volatile concepts. So it's more like both, a context and authority.
Exactly. You need both.
Exactly, you need both. So we would agree that the context is somehow a fuzzy logic, an algorithm, something that creates the context and the authority that we can accept or not.
So are we converging to a closing statement here, or
yeah.
Are there any?
Yeah, just what he said. Like,
that's what I said. I would end up with a conclusion, and we need both concept and authority, and on both, on two of these, we can consider this statement we should take into account or not.
We need context and authority of the producer and the consumer of same as.
Yeah.
I have a. Because I have this problem. I have to develop a system this year, and I have a problem with sameAs. And if you want, I have a little demo about that. Possibility to show you how I can resolve.
That's why I personally, for instance, avoid using sameAs. I prefer C also, something like this.
Too.
Because the semantics of the same
semantic.
Is quite
yes.
Dangerous.
But I can show you
yeah.
A little.
Yeah. Yes, please. Yes.
3 minutes.
Because in theory, for instance, imagine me cloned here, I wouldn't be so keen saying another me is same as me because. This 1 second of his another life makes him different. So,
well, it's very interesting that you mentioned. I was just thinking about this. We're entering a bit philosophy here.
Exactly.
It's like the ship of Theseus, if you're familiar with that conundrum. If you replace each board on a ship piece by piece, so that no original part exists, I mean, as a part of the ship, is it still the same ship? Just a similar, I've heard just recently on YouTube, you should watch Vsauce, very, very nice philosophical channel, which says just something similar about people. If I were, by some mad scientist, replicated atom by atom,
exactly. Would it be the same me?
Would I be same as the clone? So I just concluded for myself that we should, that's a matter of identity, actually. And with ontologies, it's very oversimplified. Identity is just a URI. So URI, same as URI, and then we take, as I said, everything that's said on about either resource. But thinking about actual people, the identity is actually, a personal decision. I decide that I'm myself, I bear the identity, and it's up to me to decide whether my clone is actually myself.
Yeah, but the clone would disagree with you.
Well, you would be there.
Because again, state this, but the clone would disagree. Oh no, I'm not the same as the other eye, the original one. No, I'm the original one.
I think you're overstepping here. It would be up to the clone, not to you, to decide.
But yes, again, but it's still, his statement and his authority.
Okay, before we get too philosophical.
Yes, I have exactly this problem with different scientists in my university. I work in this moment for the University of Paris-Saclay. And I need to ask for each scientist, what is your domain? What is your data set? And I try to create a link between the different domain, between the scientists. And for me, it's impossible. And I find quick solution. So currently, scientists, when I search a data set, use Google, okay, and you type your domain, cosmology or anything, and always you find the first link, Wikipedia. So the scientist now in my university can click and can connect in Wikipedia, and we can and the scientists can see immediately what the data set in the university about this domain. So I developed a specific widget in Wikipedia where you can find a new angle.
Tab.
Yes. New tab. Where you this tab is built with sparkle color, and immediately the scientists can see the different data set. For example, that's cosmology, so the website it is about cosmology, but the reality is all data set is referenced in a specific website with ontology decat, and this website, I ask for each data set specific ID of Wikidata. So scientists can select definitively an ID in Wikidata, not the name in English, but definitely ID Q with the number, and so I can translate this definitive theory.
Yeah, but do the scientists also agree to all the thousands of SameAs statements that are made through the Wikipedia entries?
Yes.
They agree to all of them?
Agree.
So this is agreement model, like consensus model. But there are already thousands of identity statements underneath, right? Because these Wikipedia...
But, yes, the scientist chose himself the good ID directly in Wikipedia.
No, but not in Wikipedia. Other sources are linking to Wikipedia and claiming to be the same.
In my form, it's not the same. This dataset speak about this domain this data set have this tag, for example. It is with ontology decat, okay? It's not exactly the same as, okay?
But I say my phone is same as your cosmology identifier. I say this is the same as I create an identifier for my phone, your router bag slash phone, and I say this router bag slash phone is same as your cosmology ID. Now, do the scientists agree to this identity statement that I just created?
I don't understand.
Okay, no. Maybe I'm a slightly.
Maybe you can ask me.
Because of the transitivity.
It's open-ended. Anybody can add facts. And will the scientists agree to the transitive closure of those facts?
For the moment, the scientists don't understand exactly what is sameAs and okay. The different theory. But the scientists can
using it.
Yes, the scientists can select very quickly. You can show you.
They probably are just using Wikipedia links as I just identity.
So this full specification says on the gender that the semantic web supports lying. that's basically the issue that you're getting at. But obviously, at some point, it becomes a nuance between what is lying and what is just saying something that's.
Yeah.
Anyone
can say anything about
exactly.
It.
Yeah, it's exactly. A platform.
Yeah. So you have to choose your
Alfred
own.
Nobel created Dynamite to do good stuff, but there was always a person that just used it. Otherwise.
So, but that gets into the personal context that we discussed some minutes ago, where you basically have to create your own bubble of
identities. So again, context and authority.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So very quickly.
And the hub.
Very simple. Scientists can select cosmology like any other things for the moment, because I can select really the different type of domain in Wikidata, but scientists can find everything in Wikidata, and so if scientists cannot find a thing in Wikidata, I speak with this scientist and I ask to create a page in Wikipedia.
everything goes through one person, so that is one way of enforcing this, of course. Let's also do this for the old web. Everybody should go through somebody in order to create a web page.
I've not another solution for me.
Yeah, this works good for kind of concepts which are anyway vague. You cannot define cosmology like hard. So I guess for this it's a good solution, because every same as will be not fixed.
After we have a lot of concepts cannot be created in Wikipedia. So after you can create another platform. But for the big concept, I think it is it's not really the Wikipedia, because the consensus is clear with Wikidata. But it's the first time before to open the big question of the semantic web, with the big ontology, etc. But First step to create a good theory immediately.
All right, we're going to move on to the next topic. Can I connect my laptop?
Yes, you can. Yeah. Go ahead.
In the meantime, I want to ask a quick question, because now it's about something totally different. Who has heard about linked data fragments? who would call himself an open data or herself? Sorry, an open data advocate. Okay, and who would call him or herself someone who's really calling out for APIs for web services?
What do you mean API for web services?
Web services. So if you would have, I will immediately go into my example of 5 minutes. That's if you go to your railway company of your country, you say I want an API to be able to create apps on top of your system. Would you do that?
Could I ask them to expose RDF? Would that be within?
And the discussion stopped.
Good.
Yeah, with your statement, the country would disagree with you.
The API is a bit vague, I find.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
What about if we replace API with Hypermedia?
Yeah.
Yes.
Hypermedia RDF, can I add that?
Just web.
One moment. I will give a bit of more of context, because it's all about context at first. Yeah, so I want a web of data to power a web of services. So I'm an open data guy. I almost hate people who go to the railway systems and ask for APIs. And I will explain. So, you know this guy, Tim Berners-Lee?
Sorry. Something
a bit.
Yeah. He's called Ted.
Yeah, but he called out for raw data, not raw services. So, what happens today is that we get this ecosystem on the web where a lot of people are asking for services, because if I want to create an app for doing route planning, then we would design something like this, right? We would create an API from to. This is cool. Okay, I would in fact find this already cool if my train company would do that, because they don't. They sued me over it for scraping the data, so that's why I'm into this. But from the moment that this would exist, then the server is actually in charge of choosing the functionalities that exist. So I hardly call this open data. I hardly call it an open service. It's a service you can use, but it's not how the web was envisioned. Because right now, if I would want to have wheelchair accessibility in this service, I would have to ask it to my to the railway company, and they would do 2 years or even longer to actually design that functionality in the API. So let's go back to transit data. It's just an example. You can apply it to a lot. But transit data is something that looks like this. You have a connection. That's something, a vehicle. It leaves at a certain moment. You can jump on it, and it ends at a certain location. It has departure time, arrival time, and a departure stop, arrival stop. And if you connect them, then you actually have a path, and that's a path you can follow. It's journey planning advice. So how does route planning in fact work? That just you have a very, this is how route planners today work. That's how Google Maps would work. It loads all the data in memory. It has one very big array, which it goes through once, and it just does, because it's sorted, so you can only go, you can go through it once. There's a shortest route planning, and you have it. So what do I propose is that we open up that. I want open data, and Hypermedia can help, and the linked data web can help to actually achieve that. And that's by just now creating resources over this data to in fact empower our algorithm. That way, our algorithm is on the client side, and not on the server side, where all the functionalities should be programmed before doing that. Furthermore, for federating, this is a really interesting idea, because now we can take part from other services as well, and we have intermodal routes and so on and so forth. So route planning now needs a bit more requests, but you can still do it in a very reasonable time. That's not a scientific statement, because it's not yet peer reviewed, but in September I hope to publish that in a serious journal. Good. So this is in fact the exactly the same like what we've done in the beginning with linked data fragments. We've done this on Sparkle endpoints, right? Sparkle endpoints, they do everything for you. They choose the functionality. If they don't want to do some federated querying in Sparkle 1.1, they just disable it. So they choose the functionality for you. So what did we do? We created triple pattern fragment servers, which would allow you to give parts of the data, and the entire Sparkle query is solved on the client side. So sorry, 1 minute. Yeah, the discussion is, can we in fact apply this to more than just this, and shouldn't we just advocate this really hard, is that we need open data and not open. On,
on the other hand, if they want to have open innovation with APIs, with more sensitive data, that's their thing, that's something different, but it's not part of the open web.
And what about showing the other parties, so people who are not necessarily 100% invested in transparency, openness, what the possible benefits might be to their institution? Other people with experience in that, do you have experience with that? Do they have now a benefit because of your app that I heard Prince Constantijn even uses now? So
That's a difficult question. It's the same question that Tim Berners-Lee actually would have mentioned in or did mention in his TED talk, mm-hmm. where he said back in 89 it was really hard to convince people to create web pages and to create websites. Mm-hmm. Right now it's our task to actually ask these people to now structure their data better on the web and not just create web pages.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's the next step, and it's hard to show the carrot.
Yeah.
So in general, where I see open data getting published, and you see often really amazing applications coming out and new stuff going on. So we have one example, again, let's stay with the train example. Mm-hmm. So they were actually creating an API, not an open data set in Switzerland, which is just publicly nicely documented, and it's actually hacking into the rail station official API by extracting some iOS API key. Yeah. And as soon as this was available and people could just easily use the API, there were tons of nice applications coming up where you could search much better for train stations and so on. Now imagine if not only this is online, but like the whole data set, people would start to do their own routing applications and would optimize it. For example, the railway station APIs often have the problem if you switch, they say like you need 5 minutes to switch from one track to the other. That might be true, it's mostly a bit conservative, that wheelchairs also can handle it, but if you have the data, you could do your own routing, like with, I know from this station to this station, I can do 1 minute 20 if I'm having a good day. So you can optimize really the stuff. So this would be for sure an example how you can do that.
Okay, very interesting stuff, guys. Can we make them to some kind of conclusion? What would we say?
I guess where the data is open, go and give the data set and not the API. Because you don't know what the people will do with it.
And show invested parties the benefits of opening up, like what can also come back as a merit to them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because the problem is, the question was really how can we do this? We agree, I suppose, in most cases that it's an advantage to get the data, not the API. But how can we persuade the people who actually have the data that they should do it? That's the main question, isn't it?
So showing the merits there would be...
Yeah.
Yeah, probably something which we could do then to show the merit is if we standardize between the different, like, again, train systems. I know for a fact there's the Google system file thingy, but the European train system is data-wise a huge mess. So there is no standards like in the overall, there is one big company who has somehow a monopoly. If there would be a RootsCress initiative to standardize this data, and then we can have applications which are built for the Belgium network and suddenly work on the Italian network, I guess this is not difficult to sell as a merit.
Mm-hmm. All right, so we got it on paper. Up for the final discussion now. Which is yours? It's titled, what do semantic web people do? They imitate the paper.
This is a paper, right? So everybody's working so hard to make sure their research work ends up on this little thing. Rectangular. There's a number of fixed pages and has to follow certain presentational rules so that you can earn your credit towards your degree or and so forth. That's not necessarily a problem, I think, but the actual problem originates maybe 50 years ago when Ted Nelson was trying to push the idea of hypertext. And short story, the way things evolved, it turned out into something where we're trying to imitate the paper in an electronic form. So we have Word, we have we have HTML itself even, to basically what we did all this time going back 500,000 years to have, you know, this particular look to some form of information that we want to get across and that's represented as such. We're not taking the, let's say, current web, dating back 26 years, to its full potential. We have hypertext, hypermedia, and so on, which can let us jump through ideas or look at the history of the ideas, see them in different contexts, how one idea formed or evolved into another idea, the drifts of the concepts, and even see the discoveries, how they were, where they originated. You know, we pick up an idea from here at one point, another idea from there, somehow that, you know, helps us formulate a new idea.
Yeah, but what interlinking, and we already mentioned hypermedia, has to do with imitating a paper? It doesn't have such a thing on a paper. Of course, you can have in books, let's say, links, a piece of text that probably may be something that you can relate to, but it's completely different in semantic work. There is a link that you can always try to the reference. It's not on the paper. You cannot have similar thing on the paper.
Right. I'm just saying that we're aiming towards generating this, whereas as web mm-hmm. scientists, and I quote or underline these and mm-hmm. highlight these, as web scientists or semantic web developers and so on,
yeah.
we're overly focused on producing something like this. The starting point, you know, what we use, the tools and so on we use,
mm-hmm.
Is only intended to generate this, whereas we can do far more with the native web stack,
mm-hmm.
everything that's available, because you can have a web page which lets you interact with some algorithm, you
mm-hmm.
can run the experiment, you can change the numbers around it and learn better due to the interactive features.
Mm-hmm.
You can have different views, you can have different devices which can
yeah.
show this information.
But actually having a paper or maybe something that is two-dimensional, it's not worth for human. Human does not think in three dimensions, mostly. Most of us has just one or two dimensions. And actually, a lot of people feel overwhelmed because of the possibilities and the interactivity of the web.
Well, then you just threw away the whole web. Because everything is
Do you read several documents simultaneously? Documents, resources. Do you gain knowledge from several places simultaneously?
Of course, my senses only allows me to read in a sequential manner.
Exactly.
I read each character at a time. However, if I come across a link which
yes.
I don't understand,
yes, you can go to this
I
link.
I can go to it and come back to it.
Yeah, but. What is the chance that you remember 100% of knowledge from the previous place that you were before going to this link? By moving to another link, there's possibility that you just forgot part of the previous thing.
No, you explore that link as useful as it is. You don't need the whole Wikipedia article
mm-hmm.
on that topic. You just read maybe two sentences.
I see your point in developing the web, but in fact, many people are just overwhelmed because of the variety of possibilities there.
Okay, so I think it's my practice of reading
mm-hmm.
when I read lots of things is that I read linearly, but I open new tabs in the background.
Yeah,
that's the basic thing. But the real benefit here occurs. I have a disclaimer. I was the first person who wrote a linked research paper like Saren is advocating without Saren as a co-author. I think the real benefit here comes when you have the option of querying the papers for related you have certain papers that have hundreds and hundreds of citations. I want to know who is criticizing the paper, who is challenging the evaluation, who's that kind of fine-grained. I'm not interested in all the 200 citations of an influential paper. I'm interested in something that targets, for example, criticizes the evaluation that was done in that paper.
that kind of granularity is what I hope to find, and this becomes relatively straightforward with link if people actually start adopting this link research. So I think that's the direction that we're going in, and that's why it's important to do it.
Agree, but you mentioned that you would like to query for some granular facts. But imagine when you read a paper, you have plenty of text, and there are just single words that can link to other places, to other facts.
So that's when you think in terms of sort of the in terms of text.
Mm-hmm.
But of course you have this nicely coded RDFA. Mm-hmm. But in addition you have RDFA that tells you much more. So you're not just thinking of the paper as a text with a link that you click. You have semantics around that link, and you have also the reverse semantics. You have somebody else who's written a paper about a certain paper, and once you take those links together.
Thank you.
Once you get that together, then it's...
The basic idea that the guys tried to stress, in my opinion, in the right way, is that the paper is not just a piece of paper. That's the main point.
Yeah.
Okay. This is how... Well, actually, even in the past, the paper isn't just a piece of paper, because there was... Let's say the intended knowledge that the authors that wrote that paper tried to convey through this piece of paper. That knowledge was simply in the author's mind. That's
exactly
the point. With today's technologies, what we can do is just to have the content of the paper as before, and in addition to that, a lot of additional material that actually links with proper semantics, different stuff that can be even other papers, but even concepts, even data, even whatever you think. That's the idea of a new way of thinking what paper is using this new technology.
Mm-hmm.
Is just to use whatever you have to make the paper a sort of new experience in research, so that if you have everything, of this kind of data, you can even write additional, let's say, application.
I'm lazy. I don't want to write this additional stuff.
You don't want to write additional stuff, but maybe you want to have such additional stuff in paper you are reading, and maybe you want also.
I'm a reviewer, and I need to go through all the semantic stuff which is annotated afterwards.
So if
I'm reviewing, then I'm also lazy. Then. Should I consider all the links, or
That's actually a good question. Why not?
But this will take a lot of time.
Of course, of course. But you know, it's not just a piece of text.
So
why do you have
to
have one?
No, it's just something
you
should use.
No, you only are in that.
Okay, so as a reviewer, I think it's going to start helping you, because you get. Especially when you're reviewing related work, which isn't supposed to be... related work is supposed to sort of place the paper in context, like coming into the conversation in a proper place. It's not just citing whoever is going to review the paper. So when you get to the point where you have a lot of links between documents, then it's going to be much easier to put this the present work that you are reviewing into context.
So I can build a machine which does the reviews from myself.
Yes.
Ah, that's good. This could be critical, that then probably it's dangerous that then these semantics could be misunderstood for such documents. So actually what I have with a PDF is I have one version which can be consumed by eyes this way, and this is fixed. It cannot be understood differently. And there I would also put the stuff which actually paper is old, and we know it keeps. So with digital media, I'm not sure if it will be around in some time. So
is it possible to support someone? Can I stand by my side?
The same argument can be made to stone tablets, which are
still around, far and you would have still lots around. Of new things which are
exactly. So there's a bit of a balance on, you know, how do we use the technologies to solve our problems? Mm-hmm. I mean, this whole thing with whether you can, it's, you know, use the machines to sort of assist the human, it's a tool. And what best way to, you know, make use of that tool by, you know, helping us, you know, cut down on that, you know, trivial parts of the reviewing that we have to do, or understanding, you know, what this whole document is about. You know, you can bubble up the parts that are essential to your needs. So if you need to look at the hypotheses of all the papers there, you can run a query for it, and you can find out, okay, who's disagreeing with who, or who's, you know, you know, agreeing, and you know, you can have it more granular
this is
level.
Then later on.
Well, you have a if you are able to represent the information on a granular level, then you have those possibilities.
It's
just
like
because
post-hoc additional use. What would make me motivate to use it upfront? I normally, if I'm writing a paper, I don't think of what will happen in 5 years with it.
Well, if. I would say that we need to sort of raise the bar on what constitutes a scientific paper.
Yeah.
So if you produce some work using the current technologies, I want to be able to reproduce you know, the essential parts of your work. If I can't, it just sounds like it's vaporware or whatever that you've developed. And maybe even use a machine to help me sort of run those experiments without me having to. Like the reviewer, what do most reviewers do? You print the paper, you read it, you might read it on your desktop.
But now you speak from a runnable paper, so actually you argue that it should not be the paper, but also the whole data set and how it's processed.
Anything that composes the research or the body work, whatever you've done. So yeah, the data and all that stuff is part of that. It's just that we're not using the current technologies to assist us with it. We're still using the old media to sort of do what we did for hundreds of years.
So what I would like, I don't know if it would be possible, but if I write my paper once in some kind of RDF style, and then I can just generate an ACM or a SIGGRAPH or whatever kind of paper out of it, because it will be not accepted one of these kind of
those
styles.
Are just views. We do those things because it seems like Springer's version, ACM's versions are okay, but on the web, you probably have better representations, or you should have better representations for the information that you want to communicate. I mean, a paper, a Springer paper, doesn't ask you to provide a video or an audio of that work. So. We just basically read the text.
That's a problem from a social point of view. I mean, as a researcher, I like the idea to publish everything with whatever I want, with my technologies, with technologies that are available on the web, because it's the best way to get the work recognized by the community and so on. Then, to be a researcher and to be evaluated as a good researcher in your country, at least in my country, I have to publish. That's the point. Publish with a reviewer that is respectable and the like Springer, like Elsevier, and the like. And they oblige you, because they oblige you, at least now, to publish such stuff in a particular view, as you call it, so a particular templating view, let's say, that is the way they, in which they are able to handle the publishing process of this paper. So from the one hand, I would like to publish everything in HTML, but then to be evaluated from my institute, from my country, as a good researcher, I need also to publish according to the, say, publisher's law, okay? And that's actually an issue. It's a real issue we have to address, in my opinion, in the community. Because, you know, from one point of view, the publisher basically recognize such very interesting new way of thinking papers, because they actually have a particular workflow and they want to keep it, and it is productive, it allows them to make money and the like. From the other side, we have a very impressive possibility, in my opinion, nowadays, to make papers as a sort of new experience. And we have to try to work in the middle, just to allow us to do this kind of stuff and to make also publisher to try to use part of what we have actually published on the web and then to publish the stuff as usual, in the usual way, in the usual environment. So having the PDF version, the template they use to produce it, because if you publish only on the web, at least in Italy, I don't know how it works in other countries, but if I publish only on the web with my format, my HTML, let's say paper, whatever is the format that I would like to use, basically, I don't have new points for being evaluating as a good researcher in my country, and then I lost my job.
I'd like to demo.
This is the closing statement because we have to wrap up.
A very quick demo of how this actually looks. Now it's LNCS. Now it's ACM. Now it's W3C recommendation. Now the view is.
So this is basically working, and you can generate a PDF from it. You can't give them the latest source, though.
The problem is that you can generate PDF from this.
Yes.
I agree with you. And it is fine if you want to publish this particular article in, say, our proceedings and this kind of stuff. But if you go to Springer, you try to provide them that PDF, they just say, what are you thinking about? That's the point, you know?
You need latest.
I think the fundamental problem I have with that is, as a researcher, I don't think we have to be overly concerned about the in the current technology and year, have to concern about the middleman, the publisher. The web worked because people were the publishers. They published their work.
As a researcher, I agree.
The publisher only gives you the binding of the book and the distribution of it and accessibility, and they charge a lot of money, tax authority of it. Taxpayers a lot of money, and you know, libraries and so on.
Yeah, but they give also authority over your.
That's a point.
Later.
If it's my work, I am the author and I own this work.
I agree, but if you
right, people, we have to wrap up. I suggest that you take the discussion.
Well,
I think
we will have time.
I think now we might have two statements.
Okay, give me one statement.
It sucks.
The world isn't ready for Sarafan's ideas yet.
The world isn't ready for this yet.
Like the institutional context, the companies you mentioned, etc., and the stakes.
Revolution is needed.
Oh, yes, that's a good one.
And burn something.
Sarafan, is it difficult to create out of this latter?
No, well, I have it. The paper I have for the demo session was converted to LaTeX and gave them.
Okay, they're not ready yet. Yeah. Other statements, something positive maybe?
I have the transformation.
It already works.
A nice addition to a nice and important addition to the daily published publication process of today.
But I think the solution is not the sentence. But with the student, we can try to propose new form of document for the student. And try to make, for example, I have a TP about the Sparker, and I try to inject in the document the query Sparker and make a dashboard, etc. And the student is very interesting by this form of document, but the old scientist is not. It's too late, maybe. I don't know.
Yeah,
right. But I think the student can integrate this different concept, and I think progressively.
Well, if you're a supervisor and you tell your new student that's coming into the system, use LaTeX or Word or this or text or whatever, they will do that. Whatever you give them, they will do that.
Mm.
And that's just going to feed itself. Next year, they want to get into a conference, they're going to do the same thing what they know, they don't want to take extra time to do it the proper way. Mm. And it,
we
you know...
This the same thing, I actually submitted a paper for this workshop and I had to comply with LCM, EC, whatever format.
Yeah, we're looking at you.
Why didn't you enforce this format?
I didn't. I said you could submit anything, but if you want proceedings, so maybe people have submitted different kind of things that we were open to them. So
basically, it depends on whether the latte sources are needed. Then it's
exactly that the point.
Then you just HTML.
So. To make this concrete, actually, it has to start bottom up. And if I look from a semantic web perspective, this actually means the workshops. So the workshops have to start doing this.
Yeah.
When this becomes mainstream in the workshop proceedings, then you have leverage towards conferences, well, maybe yeah. journals. I mean, yeah. I'm just looking at
right.
It's a long discussion. Actually, we can speak about it for a while.
Yeah,
I mean, I had a workshop in WWW last week. I ran a workshop there that was about scholarly publishing in general, and we accepted paper in HTML, but in a particular format that is Rush, that is a format that I made actually. It is very simple. It's HTML, but it is very simple. We did it in that way. Because since the proceedings were published on the ACM digital library and the publisher that was sharing them needed the LaTeX source file to publish such proceedings, the only way to do that is to allow two different ways. You ask people to submit in HTML, whatever is the format that they use, and then if the paper is accepted, you ask people to translate the HTML in LaTeX, that is more or less, no one wanted to do that, basically.
They accept words as well.
We had tried to propose a format because we took care about the automatic translation. We have style sheet, basically, that transform that HTML, that particular form of HTML, into LaTeX in ACM, into LaTeX into Springer. That's the idea. So, in my opinion, it's not only a problem of you should allow scientists, researchers to submit in HTML, and we should do that. But also, in my opinion, in order to make to convince the publisher that this is the new way to do stuff, research, you should try to go even towards the publisher direction by proposing, look, we have done this. In this beautiful format, in HTML. And with not so much effort, you can reach a format that is compliant with your publishing workflow. We did it for a workshop, but you can integrate this kind of process in your publishing process. So you can, at a certain point, accept HTML as a proper format, because you are the resources to handle this kind of publications, and of course, they just don't care because it's not convenient for them nowadays. Maybe a few days, in a few years, I hope that you can submit directly.
Let's